Good morning, everyone. As Francois said, my name is Maggie Little. I'm director of the Kennedy Institute of Ethics at Georgetown. I'm trained as a philosopher, but I'm a philosopher who's passionate about women's health. And I'm a philosopher who's studied for the last 15 years a really critical issue about clinical research and its intersection with women's health. So what I want to talk with you about for my short comments is why the topic that the Global Forum chose is so critical. Why it's a matter of social justice, and why this group, among others, is coming together to make progress on this critical issue. So let me pause there and say my thank you to the Wellcome Trust for supporting the Global Forum, to the Planning Committee to choosing this topic, and to all of you. As Francois said, it wasn't easy for everybody to get here, but as I look out on all of you and see progressive researchers, you are the vanguard who are going to take the flag forward on this issue. All right, let me start with why the question about research with pregnant women is so critical. When a girl or a woman discovers she's pregnant, it happens in a lot of different contexts. Sometimes the pregnancy is greeted with warmth and delight. Sometimes it's greeted with horror. Sometimes it's in the context of great resources. Sometimes it's in the context of few. But there's another context that we need to keep in mind that complicates pregnancy for so many women, and that's the context of serious illness. As Francois said, and it's not just my phrase, it is the phrase of this movement, if you like. Millions of pregnant women face serious complex medical illness. Pregnant women get ill. And many women who live with serious chronic illnesses get pregnant. Pregnancies complicated by illness is far more common than we might like to think. So pregnant women face heart disease, autoimmune diseases like lupus, diabetes, serious psychiatric illnesses, including, for instance, serious recalcitrant depression that carries a fatality rate of 20% a year due to suicide. Okay, pregnant women are at increased risk for that. Or let's talk the global burden of disease, HIV. We now know that pregnancy actually increases your chance of infection should you be exposed to the virus. There's something about the vaginal wall with heterosexual with pregnancy that makes it more permeable to infection by HIV. That is, pregnant women are amongst those it's most important to use microbicides in. Okay? Not to mention the treatment of the disease while pregnant. The last thing we want to do is interrupt treatment with HIV, not just because we don't want her to pass on the virus to her child, right? But because the implications for her own health of interrupting treatment for those critical 9 months can last far beyond, decades beyond, the birth of the baby. Okay. Malaria, TB, Zika. We have to confront the fact that pregnancy is not a prophylaxis against illness. And yet the research community acts as though it is. Because for all of that disease burden of the intersection of pregnancy with illness, almost no research is done with pregnant women. Now, there are many reasons for this. Foremost, a desire to protect research subjects, and with this idea that pregnant women and the fetus she carries are vulnerable. Now, let's just be really honest here. Okay. The pregnant woman might be vulnerable if she's in a low education or resource setting, but pregnancy itself does not make you vulnerable. I underscore this because when the regulations talk about vulnerability, they're actually talking about a decreased capacity to consent. So pregnant women in the regulations are grouped with prisoners, children, and those with dementia. Okay. I'm just going to repeat. Pregnancy can be a wild ride, but it doesn't intrinsically make you irrational. What the regulations were really trying to get at, I take it, is that, as we heard, pregnancy involves two beings, and two beings that are a package deal. They are biologically intertwined. And one of those beings can't consent. Okay? That's right. And that's really important. It's a consensus issue that when we start to think about research with pregnant women, we do need added protections for the fetus. And this, let me hasten to say, is a consensus issue because it has nothing to do with what your views on abortion are or what the moral status of the fetus is. Whether you think the fetus is already a full person or merely a group of organs and developing tissue or something in between, okay. Whatever you think on that controversial issue, most research with pregnant women would be done with women whose pregnancies would continue, and there will be a child, a newborn, a baby at the end of it, whose health can be affected by what happened in utero. So we all agree that when contemplating and confronting the need for research with pregnant women, we need added protections. Okay. We want to have further kinds of analyses about when it's ethical, what kind of risk we can expose the fetus to. And that's not disrespectful of the pregnant woman. That's saying that in the research context, when we're dealing with an entity that can't itself consent, we need to add special protections. Okay? So we need to respect her and have special protections. You can think, if you like, of the case of pediatrics research. Okay? Where we know we want the consent of the parents, but we also need to have extra protections for the child. Okay. Now, having mentioned pediatrics, I'll also say that research with pregnant women is more complicated even than that. Because remember what I said, they're a package deal. Okay. So what we don't want to do is just think about protecting the fetus and forgetting about the pregnant woman. She doesn't give up her right of accessing important medical care or her right to be in a research trial that might offer some medical benefit just because she's nice enough to continue a pregnancy. Okay. So the presence of the fetus can't displace the importance of the pregnant woman. And there's the challenge that we face. We have to respect and honor the pregnant woman and make sure that we have protections for the child that she would carry. And by the way, that's what she usually wants too. Okay. So it is complicated. Why then is it so important that we do research with pregnant women? Okay. Having noted that it is ethically challenging. Well, the reasons are actually pretty obvious, but I'm going to detail them nonetheless because there are so many myths and confusions about this topic. The first one is, if pregnant women get ill, we need effective treatment for those women, not only for her health, but for the health of the fetus. But pregnancy has its own distinct physiology. If we could borrow knowledge from non-pregnant people to figure out how to treat pregnant women while they're ill, we should do that in the main. That would be a great strategy. But in fact, as one researcher put it to me, the maternal placental fetal infrastructure acts as a wild card often with the pharmacokinetics and dynamics of drugs. I'm going to give you one example. So at the National Institutes of Health in the United States, where I had the privilege of twice serving as a visiting scholar working with researchers on this topic, they funded a study where some pregnant women already using glyburide to try to reduce the variance on their blood sugar levels. They had diabetes and blood sugar was out of control. And there was this awesome medication, and they were the clinicians were giving it to the pregnant women anyway. Okay, they were using the medicine. And the NIH researchers just said, can I borrow one extra vial of blood while you're on that treatment for your diabetes? Okay, to see how the drug is acting in your pregnant body as opposed to acting in a non-pregnant body. They did it, and they found the pregnant body was so quickly metabolizing that drug out. It was, as the researcher said, like trying to fill a bathtub with the drain open. They were not getting a therapeutic dose. Pregnant, you mentioned children. What we learned from pediatrics is that children are not just short adults. They have their own physiology. That's why we need to do research with them. I have news for you. Pregnant women aren't just women with a belly. Okay. Heavier, yes, but that's not all that's going on. Wildly different physiology, so we need to do the research to see how a drug would work to make sure it's effective. I'm going to give you another example. That same team of researchers then did a similar study with some pregnant women who had aggressive cancer. Remember what I said. Pregnant women get ill, and ill women get pregnant. The cancer was sufficiently aggressive, they had to be on a chemotherapeutic regime while pregnant. Okay. And again, not just for them, but a dead woman is actually not healthy for her fetus. So again, they went to women who were already under the care of a doctor receiving a medication, in this case, on chemo. And they again said, can we borrow some blood? In this case, they found out that once again the body was so quickly metabolizing it out that they achieved no therapeutic dose from the chemo, even as they discovered it crossed the placental barrier and the fetus was getting all of its toxicity. Worst case scenario. If pregnant women get ill and their bodies can be very physiologically different, then we need to do research with them. It's like the lesson from pediatrics. We often first think of protecting a population from research because we know that there can be such problems. But we also need to protect a population through research. That's what we realized with pediatrics, and that's what we're starting to realize with pregnancy. And once again, one of the lessons from those two examples I gave you of diabetes and the cancer, as complicated ethically as it can sound to do research with pregnant women, in the vast majority of cases, helping the woman's health is also helping the fetus's health. So OBs who work with seriously ill pregnant women, often the specialty is called maternal fetal medicine, they have a mantra. Their mantra is when they see a sick pregnant woman, first, treat her as though she weren't pregnant. That is, treat her, okay? Second, it's because the most important thing for a healthy baby is a healthy mom. Okay. So taking that mantra, but realizing we need an evidence base for knowing how to treat her, okay, for her sake and for her babies, is part of why we need to do research. The second reason we have to do research with pregnant women, though do it carefully, as we said, is because of safety, and indeed, fetal safety. The very reason we often resist doing research with pregnant women, concern for the fetus's safety, is why we have to do the research. Here's why. Remember, pregnant women are ill. And those women are, in fact, taking medications. I gave you the example of the diabetes and cancer, but just to use a statistic from the United States, okay. 2/3 of pregnant women in the United States use from 4 to 5 prescription medications during their pregnancy. Globally, when we start to talk about HIV, TB, malaria, millions of women have to be on medication, again, both for the sake of their health and the health of their fetus. So don't pretend that pregnant women aren't taking medication. Yet that's what we seem to do in clinical research. What we're really doing is, I believe unethically, shifting the risk to the fetus from the highly regulated, careful, controlled, responsible context of a clinical research trial that's overseen by an ethics committee and a data safety monitoring board into the unregulated, unmonitored clinic where the woman and her physician or nurse have to make an agonizing choice about whether to take this medicine or that medicine without any data. The premise of clinical research is the need to gather evidence in a controlled way so that we reduce safety worries out in the clinic, out in the field. Exact same thing with the research with pregnant women. The example is sometimes given when I talk to people about the idea of research with pregnant women, of thalidomide. Some of you will know of this drug that was taken to reduce nausea early in pregnancy and turned out to yield massive fetal deformities, okay? We can't give pregnant women a drug in a clinical trial. It might be the next thalidomide. Well, the lesson of thalidomide is actually the opposite. If we had been doing responsible research at an early stage, we would have discovered that thalidomide is actually unsafe for fetuses, and it wouldn't have made it to the clinic. Okay. We need effective treatment for pregnant women, and we need safe treatment for pregnant women and their fetuses. And to do that, we need well-designed, carefully protected, responsible research with pregnant women. Here's the third reason. The third reason we need to do research with pregnant women is social justice. So first of all, pregnant women are amongst worldwide the most vulnerable, and here I don't mean in the regulation sense of unable to consent. I just mean pregnancy is a very difficult time globally for many women. Yet they are the last research orphan. Okay. That means that pregnant women as a group, it's a group that doesn't really have its own advocacy organization, have you noticed? Because it's temporary, right? You come into it and then you leave it again, right? Our grant team was talking about this, about how we wish we could pull together an advocacy group just for pregnant women. Okay. It's a group that needs extra advocacy because of the complexities. As a therapeutic orphan, it's one of the groups that gets the least investment in our social resources and in clinical research, even as it needs it so much. There's also a social justice argument for those trials. And we're all here familiar and will be reminded of the distinction between super early trials, like phase one, where there's not a prospect of benefiting the participant. We're just trying to gather some preliminary data. Maybe we even give you such a tiny dose that it couldn't be helping your illness right now. Okay. But we're familiar with later trials that if the drug is promising, there's a prospect of medical benefit for participants. Just a prospect, because we're not sure yet. That's why we're doing the research, but a prospect of benefit nonetheless. Currently, pregnant women are the only population that can be summarily excluded from direct benefit trials without justification. One of my colleagues was talking to a researcher on an early microbicide trial. We've gotten past this now, I'm happy to say. But an early research with microbicide, who was saying, I can't believe it. It's such a pain on my trial. The women and girls keep falling pregnant, and I have to get rid of them on the trial. It really messes with my data. And my colleague said, why aren't you including them in the first place? After all, the women who are most at risk for HIV are the ones who are having unprotected sex, and so that means they're also at risk of being pregnant. Of course they're falling pregnant on your trial. And by the way, we know that pregnancy increases the transmission rate, so aren't these the people? And they'll need to use it, so don't we need to study to make sure that the vaginal wall isn't messing with it when it's pregnant, when you're pregnant? And the researcher, who was a woman, said, I don't know, it's just my bias. Now, bias shouldn't drive decisions about research inclusion. Nor, by the way, should convenience. Consensus on international norms for research ethics. Mere convenience of the researcher is no justification for determining who is included in the trial. It has to be determined by what's scientifically needed in the population and on justice, equal access amongst those scientifically of interest to that trial. Currently, you're not required on those very, 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 very long forms you have to fill out for a protocol. There's nothing that says, explain why you're not including pregnant women, or what's your plan, like we do have in pediatrics, what's your plan for getting the evidence at least down the road for this subpopulation? But if you do want to include pregnant women, you have to justify it, right? Get that asymmetry? Well, the results are pretty predictable. We follow incentive structures. Research is hard enough, right? That's unjust. And we do think the governing bodies are starting to change this. So, for instance, wonderfully, with this new realization, organizations coming out saying, we have to promote responsible research with pregnant women. The WHO, okay, PAHO, under Carla's wonderful direction, the American College of Obstetrics, Gynecology, and the American Pediatric Association, we need to do responsible research with pregnant women for the sake of the women and the children. Okay? There's actually bills in the United States Congress right now on just this issue. We need to rethink this issue. Now, the US Congress being what it is, don't hold your breath. But just as an indication of people realizing we need to encourage the research, okay? Now here's the last thing I want to share with you. What I've said so far is it's critically important that we address this issue for several reasons: safety, efficacy, social justice, okay? Agreed, consensus that it's more complicated because we all want to make sure that we're protecting that future child, okay? The last thing I want to share with you is the regulations allow research with pregnant women. There's just a surprising level of confusion and actually myths that it's in principle unethical. And that's false. I want to say it again. That's false. Governing regulations that are in the United States or international, the highest professional norms, so SIOMS, the Council on International Organizations of Medical Science. I think I finally got it right, right? Highly influential and important group establishing best practices. Encourages research with pregnant women and says it's absolutely not only permissible, but important. The United States regulations on protection of human subjects, subpart B, which is the one that's all about pregnancy, actually says research with pregnant women is fine. Here's the framework, but it's absolutely fine. And in fact, the framework makes a lot of sense. Can I share it with you in like five sentences? Okay. My gift to you, subpart B, done in five sentences. I should try it as a wrap someday, but I'm just going to do it in five sentences or so. Without all of the, so what subpart B, and I mention this in part because US-funded research all has to be compliant with it, but also because many countries sort of adopt it, right, as its framework, and it's actually, I think, pretty well thought out. What it says is, when you get to pregnant women, first of all, you need to do all the normal research protections that apply to anybody, like make sure you're being really clear when you ask for informed consent of the pregnant woman. Okay, make sure that any risk in the trial is minimized, that is the least needed for scientific, just boilerplate. Okay, And then there are a couple of things that are specific. The most important is it will divide and ask you, is your trial a super early stage that doesn't bring prospect of benefit to the participants? Okay, it's one of those early ones. If that's true, then the research needs to impose the risk we put on for the fetus is capped. It's just like we do with pediatrics research. It needs to be minimal risk, kind of the risks of everyday life. Hard to interpret, but there we are. Okay? But absolutely, you can do it. Far more importantly, because we don't usually do that early stage research with pregnant women. We're usually more interested in taking medication we know about and finding out now, so later stages. So the more important piece is, if it's a trial that offers participants some prospect of direct benefit, doesn't even have to be a lot, okay? If it offers prospect either to the woman or the fetus, or both, then the risks just need to be reasonable relative to what that prospect is. Just like normal research, people. Just like normal research. Okay. So in fact, the challenge and constraint and worry about research with pregnant women is not due to regulations. It's due to the culture around this issue. And that's good news, because we're the people who constitute the culture. So starting to look at progressive research with pregnant women, the models that we can follow, there are a lot of success stories out there that when you're thinking of doing research, you can ask yourself, should pregnant women be included at some stage in this? How would it work? Okay. How do I explain this to my ethics review committee or my institutional review board? Okay. Lots of material out there. The most important thing I want to say is it's a critically important issue. Fabulous research is being done. It's endorsed the importance by WHO and other leading organizations. The regulations allow it. It just takes will. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. It's really inspiring. I'm Nikki Shindo from WHO. I'm coming from more health emergency and high threat pathogens background. So I have worked in many outbreaks. And so our challenge really is that some outbreaks like H1N1 pandemic and Ebola outbreaks and currently Zika, they involve pregnant women. And many interventions don't have basic information about the interventions in pregnant women. And antivirals, they have been never tested, and there's no proven safety profile. So we have to, in the normal circumstances, we have to exclude them. Mm-hmm. But we see more fatality, more severe illness in pregnant women. It's a live or die situation. Why can't we use? First, we have to get approval to use the antivirals or interventions. The second, we have to get approval to get specimens and research protocol approved from the Ethics Review Committee. So normal situations, I think there are many issues I would like to learn from this meeting. But for those emergencies, we have really focused interest on pregnant women. So when we don't have a concrete data from usual situations, we can't use them. So, but in normal situations, in very high resource settings, there's some hiccups and repercussions from obstetricians, because they don't really want, they're already vulnerable being sued and stuff like that. So so I don't think it's only people like us that working in the clinical research field, but also coming from very central group, which is obstetricians. Mm-hmm. So my question would be, how are you dealing with this repercussion from the main doers of the research?
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for that. You're absolutely right that there are lots of impediments, okay? And we can divide them into a few different categories. One is scientifically and ethically responsible research can be complicated when you figure out how to stage and how to get early enough safety data to be able to do first in pregnant woman research. And that's usually a challenge we can deal with. We have to learn about the specifics of that disease, the background risk, what we know about the molecule, all sorts of things, right? And we'll be looking at lots of case studies across these 2 days, including Zika, okay? Second, you're absolutely right that there can be reticence on the part of funders and reticence on the part of approvers to do the research. So when I said culture, and I didn't mean to be dismissive, culture, I heard one phrase, culture eats strategy for breakfast. So when I say culture, I'm not diminishing it, I'm naming it, okay? And it's not just the researchers who are constituting that culture. It's also the reviewers and the lawyers who are advising them, et cetera, okay? Research ethics committees, et cetera. What I wanted to emphasize is it's not that the regulations themselves say you can't do it. So thank you for that opportunity to make the clarification. And then on specific things about how to move forward in emergency settings, not that you want this, but the silver lining of those is that people are being forced to recognize pregnancy and the need to do research. You can't, I mean, Zika, it's like about pregnancy. Then the specific advice is very, very specific to the particular pathogen, et cetera. But part of what we'll be gaining across these 2 days are examples about how to design a trial in a creative, responsible way that can get data even when it's at an early stage.
Thank you. I'm Claude Chirumhuzia from Uganda. Prof, the three reasons you gave are convincing, but we have a problem.
Can you stop there? That was good.
You have the law on one side and ethics on the other. Mm-hmm. When you look at, if I look at the African situation, we have strongly patrilineal societies. The spouse has strong influence. He needs to be consulted. The family is there. And now the law, you find, is leaning towards the spouse, the family. And now the woman has to take the decision. Mm-hmm. Then you go to the drug company. The drug company will be fearing the repercussions in case something goes wrong. So how do we reconcile the situation? Yeah, we see the reason for the woman to take the decision, but the drug company will be worried. In case something goes wrong, I'm in trouble. So how do we reconcile those two sides? Thank you very much.
Excellent question. Thank you very much. Again, part of what this is helping to do is to start to name different kinds of constraints and challenges that will each need their own strategy, okay? The legal drug company worry about liability. My wonderful colleague, Anna Mastroianni, will be talking about a bit later. And I know she'll only have a few minutes for her presentation, but she's somebody that you could also talk to along with Leslie Henry next to her. Yes, right there. Okay, very important issue. In terms of dynamics around whose buy-in and actually permission is culturally needed for the woman to be able to say yes. Deeply important question. And I know there are several cases on the docket in these 2 days that are going to be looking at that issue. The central thing I would say here is it is, in a way, an example that goes beyond pregnant women. I mean, this one is specific to the husband. But there are challenges that we know about and some best practices that we know about how to try to get enrollment in a cultural and community context where there are multiple people who actually have say, okay? And how to deal with gender dynamics, okay? They're gonna be all over the place with this one. The only reason I'm saying this is because some of the issues that we're gonna face and talk about over these 2 days with research with pregnant women, we're gonna hear lessons that we've been looking at with research with women at all, right, with girls and women in certain settings. And bottom line, some of the issues about establishing trust and buy-in before you try to start the trial, having community representatives, but it has to be very granular strategies for different communities.